Hey, Mac, have you caught anything?
I hadn't caught a single thing. I've been out here all morning. I hadn't got a single bite.
Have you tried casting on the other side?
What? Are you kidding me? Cast your nets on the other side. That sounds like familiar lines from the Gospels, doesn't it? Should call to mind lots of the great stories that we've learned from the Gospels about Jesus and his disciples around the Sea of Galilee. Now, this is really the Craighead Forest Lake, not the Sea of Galilee. The lake is relatively small, only about 60 acres. Meanwhile, the Sea of Galilee, which of course is a freshwater lake, not really a sea, is about 41,000 acres in size, making the Sea of Galilee something like 70 times as large as Craighead Forest Lake. As you look across this lake, you might see access too with a large pavilion. And could you just picture Jesus in a little boat just off of the bank, speaking to a big crowd, telling the parables of the sower and the weeds and the mustard seed? Or across the way on the north shore is the town of Jesus, not Bethlehem where he was born, not Nazareth where he grew up, but his town of Capernaum. And near there, Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount. At the opposite end of the Sea of Galilee, you would find near the south shore the region of the Gadarenes. Do you remember what happened there? The story of Legion, where Jesus cast out the demons and the pigs rushed down the cliff. By the way, many stories surround storms on the sea, high winds and choppy waves, and then Jesus stills the sea. Peace, be still. And another time when Jesus came walking across the water and Peter got out of the boat to walk towards him. At the end of the Gospel of John, Jesus meets the disciples on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. The disciples had been fishing, and that's where Jesus asked Peter three times if he loved him. Can't you just picture Spencer out here in a little boat on the edge of Craighead Forest Lake, all of us on the banks listening to the next sermon? Wouldn't that be great? But today's story starts on the Sea of Galilee with some fishermen whose lives are about to change. Hello, everybody. Hope you've already had some good fishing today. Welcome back to Class on the Hill. This is Mack Talk number 3. Not as short as a TED Talk, not as long as a Spencer Talk, and not as good as either one. But thanks for joining us today. The first lesson, do you remember? It was the baptism of Jesus. The second lesson, the temptations of Jesus. And today we'll be looking at the call of the first disciples of Jesus. Now, next week's lesson, I hope you'll be here for it because it's going to be the most important one. Now, before we get to today's story, I wanted to look at something from one of the songs in our book that we sing sometimes. One of my favorites, number 915. Do you know which one that is by the number? Trust and Obey. So I'm going to look at parts of two verses and see how they kind of give a little bit of the theme of what's coming up in the lesson. Verse 4 says, "But we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay." Then into verse 5, "What he says we will do, where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey." So today's story finds Jesus on the Sea of Galilee. Did you know that the Sea of Galilee is the lowest freshwater lake in the world? It's at 705 feet below sea level. And did you know that the Dead Sea is the lowest saltwater lake in the whole world? It's at 1,388 feet below sea level. Okay, that's just some trivia, but let's go to some Bible questions. Our first round of Bible questions for this morning. Now, it might depend on the Bible version that you like to use, but there are at least four names that I can find that are used in reference to that central lake that is used in the time of Jesus. I'm not talking about the Dead Sea. All right. So the first one is going to be easy. Of course, you're going to get it. The Sea of Galilee. But it's the other three that you got to think about a little bit. See if you can come up with them. Did you get the Sea of Tiberias? Did you get the Lake of Gennesaret? All right, extra points if you get the last one. The Sea of Chinnereth. Okay, that's the four names for the Sea of Galilee. Today, the Israelis actually call it the Sea of Galilee, but sometimes they call it Kinneret, which is Hebrew for violin, because they say the shape of the lake is something of a violin. Today, the Sea of Galilee actually provides one-third of the nation's drinking water in Israel. It's also used for fishing and, of course, for tourism. But as we look back to the time of Jesus, fishing and fresh water is what it's all about. So we have a Bible class today. Is it okay in a Bible class to actually have a test? How about three tests? Today we're going to be looking at three tests. I used to think that the disciples were working by the sea, fishing, when a man, maybe unknown to them, walked by and called them, and they just dropped everything and left to follow Jesus without really knowing who he was. But I think further study shows that they actually had come into contact with Jesus and knew him some before they left the nets. So, let's look at a few more Bible questions as we get started. Number one, who were the brothers who were disciples? Number two, what was their occupation? Number three, who were their fathers? And number four, what were their nicknames? All right, so the first one is probably pretty easy for you. Who were the brothers who were disciples? Of course, you got James and John. You got Peter and Andrew. I don't know about this next one. How about Thomas? Because he was Didymus, the twin. Is it possible one of the other guys was his twin brother? Don't think it really tells us. Okay, so their occupation, you got that. All four of those guys, Peter and Andrew, James and John, were fishermen. Who were their fathers? James and John, you probably got, didn't you? James and John were the sons of Zebedee. Peter and Andrew, a little bit more difficult. Got to kind of find it when Jesus talks to Peter and he calls him Peter, son of John, or Barjona. And so I guess that was the father of Peter and Andrew named John or Jonah. From John 1:41, you could find that. Now, nicknames. Probably got Peter's nickname, Simon Peter, Peter, or Cephas, which means rock. And then James and John. Got to think of a little bit for that one. Did you get it? Boanerges, the sons of thunder. Maybe tell us a little bit about their personality. How'd you do on the opening round of questions? Hope you got them. I want to start our story now in John chapter 1, verse 35. We're going to read through one of the first times it appears that Jesus comes into contact with some of his disciples. John 1:35. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples when he saw Jesus passing by, and he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying and spent that day with him. It was about the 10th hour. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who had heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah, that is, the Christ." And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here is a man of Israel, in whom there is nothing false." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you under the fig, because I saw you under the fig tree. You shall see greater things than this." He then added, "I tell you the truth, you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Okay, in that short passage, did you notice several of the different ways or names for Jesus that were referenced there? He was called the Lamb of God. In verse 36, he was called Rabbi and Teacher. In verse 38, he was called the Messiah and Christ. In verse 41, he was called the Son of God. In verse 49, as well as the King of Israel. And verse 49, and Jesus calls himself the Son of Man at the end of the passage. But I want to focus for a second on what Jesus said. In verse 39, he said, "Come, and you will see." And then in verse 43, Jesus says, "Follow me." And that's what they did. Verse 39 tells us, though, how long they followed him. Verse 39 says, they spent the day with Jesus. Talk about carpe diem. They seized that day, and I'm sure they learned a lot. But the passage in John, it seems more of an introduction between Jesus and these disciples, a getting-to-know-you day. It's not clear that they really stuck with him at that point. So next we're going to look at Matthew chapter 4. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. And we're going to read from Mark chapter 1. The passage will sound almost the same as the Matthew passage. This is Mark chapter 1, verse 16. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. So there they are in the Sea of Galilee. You notice Peter and John, they were casting their nets. James and John were preparing their nets. They're a little bit farther on from Peter and Andrew. And Jesus said, "Come, follow me. I will make you fishers of men." They left their nets at once. James and John left their father Zebedee and the hired servants and followed Jesus at once. Now, they clearly left their fishing nets and their father behind. But did something happen after that? They appeared to return to fishing, I think. Maybe Jesus wasn't ready for these four full time yet because he hadn't called all the others yet. I don't know, whatever it is that happened, for some reason, a short time later, we're going to go to another passage in Luke chapter 5. Oh, how I wish we knew more of the details. We're going back to the Sea of Galilee and look at who's fishing again, but we don't know how many days have passed. It's a different scene. I really wish Luke had included for us a little bit of the passage of time. Come on, Luke, a few more details for those of us with inquiring minds who want to know. But this is Luke chapter 5 now, and we'll see another scene on the Sea of Galilee. Luke chapter 5, verse 1. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret with the people crowding around him, and listening to the word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then John said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men." So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. I think one thing we should remember is that for these four men, Peter and Andrew, James and John, fishing is their job. It wasn't just a hobby. It's not just something on the weekend to do for fun. This is their job. You notice in verse 3 that Jesus says he sat down and taught the people from the boat. Luke didn't tell us the sermon. Come on, Luke. We would like to have heard the sermon. But we don't get the sermon. We know that they're on the Lake of Gennesaret, also known as the Sea of Galilee. And the crowds of people, it says, were so great upon him, but they listened to the Word of God. And it was God's Word they were listening to, not just someone's opinions, not just fluff, but the Word of God. It says Jesus sat down and taught from the boat. Now, come on, wouldn't this be fun? What if one day we really did go out to Craighead Forest Lake? Can't you just see Spencer out in a little boat? And he's talking to us while we're standing on the side, on the shore, listening to a great lesson. And then after that, we're going to have a picnic. All right, we'll put that on the planner for later. Jesus presents a test for his young fishermen, the young fishermen disciples. Verse 2 says they had already washed their nets. Okay, that means they're finished fishing for the day. Verse 5 says they had already worked all night and caught nothing. All right, they're tired, probably frustrated, and now Jesus, the carpenter, Jesus, the teacher, comes and tells the fishermen how and what to do. Jesus said, put down your nets for a catch. And when Jesus said, put down your nets for a catch, he didn't say, put down your nets and let's just see how things go. He didn't say, let's put out the nets and see if we get lucky. He has confident expectation, kind of the way James talked about how our prayers should be. Verse 5, Peter makes this great response. And you know, Peter doesn't always say the right thing. But here in chapter 5, Peter says the right thing. He said, but because you say so. Well, first he says, Master, we've fished all night, caught nothing. But because you say so, I will let down the nets. I think the King James Version says, nevertheless, because you say so. It's great wording there. Because Peter acknowledges we fished all night and didn't catch a thing, but we're willing to listen to you. He's willing to submit to what Jesus said. I have read that usually in the Sea of Galilee, they would fish at night in the shallow waters. And now Jesus said, I want you to fish during the daytime in the deep waters, something not quite what they're used to. And they had to trust in Jesus and obey, and they saw what happened. Now, it is a sign of real trust, the sign of true discipleship. When we're tired and frustrated, maybe even in doubt, can we still trust Jesus enough to say, nevertheless, because you say so, I will do it. That really is trust and obey in action. Now, you know, it's Peter and all four of these disciples, they passed the first test. They did exactly what Jesus said. They trusted him. They went fishing again. The second test is coming. It's going to be harder than the first test. Verse 6 says, they caught so many fish, their nets were breaking. They caught so many fish, they filled up two boats. So here comes the second test. How did it happen? Who gets the credit? Peter could have said, I did it. We did it. We caught all these fish. Or Peter could have said, look how lucky we were. How did we catch all these fish? It was just luck. But Peter did understand it was a miraculous event from the Lord. And again, Peter says the right thing. He confesses his own sinfulness. And they're all astonished at what's just happened. They've passed the second test. They give credit to God. There's an interesting verse from Isaiah chapter 6, verse 5 that kind of fits, I think, in a connection. Isaiah says, woe to me, I cried. I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. My eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. I think that Peter kind of is reflecting that verse. But the third test is coming. I think it's the most difficult test that they're going to get from Jesus today. Jesus said, when they came back, don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men. First, the calming words of Jesus, do not be afraid. How much of our lives do we live in fear? Fear of the unknown, fear of the COVID, fear of the deep waters, fear of the challenges to tell others and become fishers of men ourselves. Jesus says similar words in the previous calling. Remember when we read from Matthew and Mark? Basically, should we also become fishers of men, or should we leave that to the professionals? You know, let's leave the fishers of men to the pros, like the professional fishermen, the tax collectors, the doctors, the tent makers, the carpenters. Those were the pros who did the who became fishers of men 2,000 years ago. Okay, here comes the third test. Do you see what's coming here? Remember, these men, Peter, Andrew, James, and John, are all professional fishermen. And think of what's just happened. Well, they hit the jackpot. It's the big payday. Maybe their biggest catch, maybe their biggest catch of their whole lives. It's profit. It's security. It's new clothes. It's a new boat. It's money in the bank. It's time to pay all those bills. But what do those professional fishermen do on their biggest payday? Verse 11 says, so they pulled up their boats on shore and left everything and followed him. Well, how did they do that? I think that's trust and obey in action. Could I do that? Could you do that? Can you think of someone who could not do that in the Bible? How about the rich young ruler? He couldn't sell everything and give to the poor and follow Jesus. And he walked away sadly. There's kind of two choices here in the response. Either you leave everything and follow Jesus, or you walk away sadly. It's interesting in another story a little bit later, Mark 10:28, Peter says to Jesus, we have left everything to follow you. They actually did and followed through with it. As we come to the end of the lesson today, I really want us to just kind of think about those three tests for a minute. Can we pass these tests? The first test, nevertheless, because you said so, I will do it. It's kind of like submitting to God's will be done. The second test, can we give God the credit for the good things in life? Not take credit ourselves, not attribute it to luck, but realize that God is the source of all good things. And the third test, can we really leave it all behind? Can we really become fishers of men? Can we pass the three tests? Well, I hope so. And I hope you've enjoyed today's lesson. Thanks for tuning in. Hope you'll be back next week, because next week's lesson, as you might guess, is going to be the most important lesson. See you next week. Same bat time, same bat channel. Good fishing this week.